So today I'd like to introduce Dr. Melissa Curry. Dr. Curry is a professor of pediatrics and chief of the Norton Children's Pediatric Protection Specialists and medical director of the COSAIR Charities Division of Pediatric Forensic Medicine. Dr. Curry received her medical degree from the University of Louisville School of Medicine and completed her residency in pediatrics at the Medical College of Wisconsin. The subspecialty of child abuse has evolved during her career, and Dr. Curry became board certified in child abuse pediatrics in 2009 when the examination was first offered. She has essentially created the Division of Pediatric Forensic Medicine at Norton Children's Hospital and the University of Louisville, which now contains multiple attendings, nurse practitioners, nurses, and even a fellowship program. She sits on the legislated Kentucky Child Fatality Review Panel and provides training about recognition, intervention, investigation, and prosecution of child maltreatment to a wide variety of academic and professional audiences. She is also a founding member of the Face It movement, which is a multidisciplinary community action group that is committed to ending child maltreatment in Kentucky over the next decade. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Curry, and I'll turn it over to you today.
Thank you very much, Dr. McDonald, for that kind introduction. And hello, everyone. We are going to be learning today about understanding abusive head trauma, pediatric abusive head trauma. And I will go ahead and just dive right in. If my slides will advance, give me one moment here. There we go. Today we are going to define and describe abusive head trauma and its associated injuries. We're going to review statistics about pediatric abusive head trauma, and we're going to talk some about the medical evaluation and follow-up of a patient with abusive head trauma. So to start, I think that it's helpful to understand why we no longer use the terminology shaken baby syndrome. Since about 2009, we have been using terminology abusive head trauma in the medical field, and many other professionals have adopted that terminology as well. First, it's because this is not a phenomenon that's limited to just babies. It's seen regularly in children who are older, toddlers, or even younger school age children. And so consequently, we don't want to have a name for this diagnosis that artificially restricts the age group of patients that could be victims. Also, we know from decades of research now that often the mechanism of injury for abusive head trauma is not limited to shaking alone. While shaking is clearly the most common mechanism and is likely involved in most all of the cases, some, but not all cases involve impact and other mechanisms as well. Abusive head trauma is the most common cause of morbidity and mortality in physical child abuse, and that's important to understand. It usually occurs in children younger than 1 year of age, but as I mentioned on the last slide, older children can be victims as well. And this is the most common cause of death from brain injury in children less than 1 year of age. And I think that that sometimes comes as a surprise to folks who might guess that household falls or car accidents or similar accidental mechanisms would be the most common cause of brain injury in our youngest infants. And that is not the case, unfortunately. So this is a key idea that will kind of be woven throughout the presentation today, and I think is helpful to understand, and that is that it is very rare for a child to die or to be permanently disabled from maltreatment the very first time they're abused or neglected. This tends to be a pattern of behavior that escalates over time as opposed to a one-off event, and I think that that's really important, especially when it comes to our recognition and intervention in child maltreatment. Here in Kentucky, on average, we have about 50 children die under circumstances of maltreatment each year. And on average, about almost 90 children are involved in near fatal incidents each year. And a near fatality is actually defined at the federal level. And we use that same definition here. And that is an act which, as certified by a physician, results in a child being in serious or critical condition due to alleged maltreatment. And for the past few years, Kentucky has had the unlucky distinction of having the highest child victimization rate in the United States. So what is abusive head trauma exactly? Well, it's brain injury. And again, it can involve shaking, impact, or both. The most common injury that we see in association with the brain injury is subdural hematoma, and we can see that on a CT scan. We can see retinal hemorrhages in the backs of the eyes. We can see scalp bruising or skull fracture if there has been impact involved. But again, it's the injury to the brain tissue itself that causes the death and disability in these infants. In babies, the most common trigger is crying, and in toddlers, probably the most common trigger is toilet training accidents. And again, this is not typically a one-time event. In more than half of our victims of abusive head trauma, there's evidence of prior injury. So shaking can cause injury by stretching and damaging the bridging veins that are exiting the surface of the brain cortex here and emptying, draining the blood into this structure in the midline, which is called the superior sagittal sinus. And this basically serves as a drainage ditch for the blood coming from the brain to be pumped or to flow to the heart to then be pumped to the lungs. And as these little veins, bridging veins, exit the surface of the brain is violently being shaken back and forth while this sinus is actually permanently fixed or attached to the inside of the skull. And so consequently, those little bridging veins get torn and they bleed in the space underneath the dura. So that is where the term subdural comes from, is that it's underneath sub the dura. And again, subdural bleeding is most often initially detected on CT scan. We follow up all abnormal CT scans with MRI, and we do have a sizable number of cases that are detectable only on MRI. And so we have to have a pretty low index of suspicion in order to obtain those MRIs, which show us more detail and can detect more subtle subdural hemorrhages and parenchymal brain injury. So this statement was issued by the American Academy of Pediatrics back in 2001. So it's 20 years old now. And the AAP still stands by this statement, although we don't call it shaken baby syndrome anymore. And that is that the act of shaking leading to shaken baby syndrome is so violent that individuals observing it would recognize it as dangerous and likely to kill the child. I think this is a really helpful statement to help us understand the amount of violence that's involved. This is not something that occurs if a baby's head isn't adequately supported while holding them, or by bouncing them on our knee, or even tossing them in the air to play airplane. These are violent acts that are causing the brain injury and subdural hemorrhage that we see in abusive head trauma. There are associated injuries as well. I've already mentioned the retinal hemorrhages and skull fractures, but we can see rib fractures, and really we can see fractures of any bone in the body. Sometimes we see bruising, sometimes we see abdominal injury, but commonly we will see nothing. So often these babies look completely normal on the outside, aside from their neurological dysfunction. And so again, we have to have a low or a high index of suspicion, a low threshold for a workup for these children. So the signs and symptoms can be vague and easily mistaken for more benign problems. And we're going to talk in a minute about how these children often present. But one thing that is helpful to understand is that this is a diagnosis that's sometimes missed or misdiagnosed by healthcare professionals, because it's frankly not an easy diagnosis to make, particularly in the more subtle injuries. So We sometimes identify abusive head trauma in infants who present with bruises, enlarging head. So if the head circumference is enlarging out of proportion to the growth of the length and weight of the body, that can be a red flag and can be an indication to do some outpatient imaging. Vomiting in the absence of diarrhea, particularly when it's persistent and not consistent with a typical reflux or viral illness sort of picture. We certainly don't advocate for doing head CTs in every child that presents with persistent vomiting, but it certainly needs to be on the differential diagnosis that the vomiting is being created by increased intracranial pressure as opposed to a GI process. Sometimes babies present with extreme irritability or fussiness, or they're being described as colicky, whereas that they weren't colicky before their injury. Sometimes they present as lethargic or sleepy, poorly responsive, or seeming spaced out. And then again, seizures can be a presenting sign. Sudden limpness or loss of tone, breathing difficulty, gasping for breath, or just complete cessation of breathing. The brief resolved unexplained event. So what we now call the BRUI, that used to be called the ALTI, is oftentimes, certainly not always, but oftentimes the symptoms that are being detected from the brief resolved unexplained event are the concussion symptoms that we are seeing as a result of the injury to the brain. And just like the football player who can be concussed on the field and lose consciousness, babies can wake back up from their concussion and seem otherwise okay, just as we see with the BRUI. Sometimes abusive head trauma is found as an incidental finding, meaning that it's an injury that otherwise wouldn't have been suspected from the physical examination or history, but it is found because, for example, the child has head imaging for some other reason. Bright red blood from the mouth of infants, that is a red flag and oftentimes is a result of a torn frenulum or sometimes from oropharyngeal trauma or even esophageal trauma that is inflicted. And then, of course, the torn frenulum on exam. So one of the things that we're going to spend quite a bit of time here on is bruising, talking about the kinds of bruising that cause us to be concerned for inflicted injury. And there is a clinical decision rule that was actually developed here in Louisville originally and is now being used internationally as a way to distinguish bruises that are concerning for maltreatment from bruises that are more typical from accidental injury. And that is now called the 10-4 faces P bruising rule. Now you may have heard of the 10-4 bruising rule in the past, and there was recently a study and a paper published this year that expanded the bruising clinical decision rule to include the faces P part. And I'm gonna go through all of those components here, but here is the first part of the rule. Any bruising of the torso, ears, or neck, so that's where you get the T-E-N, in a child 4 years of age or younger, or any bruising anywhere in an infant who is not independently mobile or less than 4.99 months. So that number four comes up again when we're talking about the babies as well. And you can see as an example here, this is an example of torso bruising. So the torso includes the buttocks, the genitalia, the belly, the back, the chest, and up to the neck. And here you can see torso bruising on this young child who has multiple parallel linear contusions that are consistent with multiple overlapping blows with an open hand. This is clearly diagnostic of inflicted child physical abuse. In this next example, you can see an example of ear bruising. You can see the purple red discoloration down in the crevices of the ear, and you can also see a little bit of faint bruising on the side of the cheek. This is highly specific for inflicted injury, especially in a non-mobile infant. And so ear bruising should always get our attention when it comes to child maltreatment. And then this is an example of neck bruising. You can see some torso bruising down here as well on this child, but this kind of ovoid purple-brown contusion is on the neck or the angle of the jaw, depending on your perspective. And that is a really ominous location for bruising. In my years of doing this so far, I have yet to see bruising to the angle of the jaw that was accidental. I'm sure that it can and does happen. It's just not something that I've seen yet in my practice. So that's the 10-4 component of the bruising rule. And then there's also FACES P. So FACES P stands for frenulum, angle of the jaw, cheek, meaning the soft portion of the cheek, eyelids, S is, I'm completely drawing a blank, subconjunctiva, sorry, my Zoom projection was covering up my cheat sheet there, subconjunctiva, and then P is for patterned injury. And so here are some examples that I'll try to go through briefly that just demonstrate how the 10-4 FACES P bruising rule can help help us detect inflicted injury in children. So this was a 9-month-old baby girl who was brought to the emergency department after mother felt that she just wasn't acting herself and had this bruise on her belly after being in the care of a new caregiver. This baby was alert and looked relatively good on physical exam, had a nice soft belly exam with no masses, and was really overall clinically doing very well. But since she had a bruise on the torso, and in this case, she was a non-mobile infant, she deserved the full evaluation for occult injury, and that included a skeletal survey, a head CT, and screening abdominal trauma labs. And in her case, it was her trauma labs that came back highly abnormal with liver enzymes in the thousands, and that bought her an abdominal CT, which revealed a grade 3 liver laceration. So multiple individuals had examined this child's belly. None of us were able to detect any tenderness or discomfort or mass, yet she had what was a potentially life-threatening injury inside her belly. So that's an example of how even one single subtle bruise can be evidence of serious injury going on inside. The child on the right here was a victim of abuse because he was assaulted in the course of a domestic violence incident between his parents. A neighbor overheard the babies crying and the parents yelling. I apologize for the dog barking in the background. And a neighbor called 911. And when they arrived at the apartment, this baby was being described by parents as napping. However, what he actually was unconscious. And so the social worker who did the welfare check on this baby did a wonderful job by turning on the lights and undressing the baby. And she was able to see all of this bruising on the belly here. This baby, again, wasn't waking up despite having the lights turned on and the clothes removed, and was transported to the Children's Hospital by ambulance, where he was found to have a duodenal hematoma, a liver laceration, as well as multiple fractures. Thankfully, his brain was okay. He required emergency surgery, multiple blood transfusions, and did survive, thankfully. Here are several examples of ear bruising. You can see here on your left, this child has bruising to the posterior aspect of the ear involving the helix. This child was picked up and thrown by his ear, so that's a crush injury. This little girl was in the intensive care unit with a liver laceration and multiple other skin injuries, and you can see how her bruising actually appears somewhat reddish and could have been mistaken for rash if it was not detected in the setting of multiple other injuries. And then here is some more subtle ear bruising. You can see some large petechia, small contusions on the inside of the ear here. And you can also see just a very small, subtle contusion on the ear lobe as well. So those are examples of ear bruising. Neck bruising. Admittedly, the neck and the angle of the jaw portions of this clinical decision rule overlap somewhat, and it really doesn't matter which you label it as. But this area of the body, again, is a very ominous location for bruising in children, and we often will see it in association with abusive head trauma. This child on the left was 2 years of age and presented with ultimately fatal abusive and abdominal trauma. And you can see the neck slash angle of jaw bruising there on him. And then this child on the right has a different pattern of neck bruising. He was taken to an urgent care early in the morning because mom was concerned he had an ear infection because he was fussy. The nurse practitioner asked about the bruising. Mom thought it was because he had slept on a Lego in his crib the night before. Police and CPS were involved, and ultimately mom's boyfriend admitted to strangling the child until the child passed out. And so these are the kinds of bruises we can sometimes see with strangulation. And thankfully this child woke back up because that is not always the case. And then from TEN, the last part is four before we go into the faces component, and that's any bruising anywhere on an infant who is not yet independently mobile. These are both pictures of very subtle bruising on very young infants. The one on the left was 6 weeks old. The one on the right was 4 months old. In both infants, the infant otherwise presented completely well. Both were seen at the pediatrician for a well-child exam, and because of the bruising, were sent to the ER for a full evaluation. And both of these children were found to have multiple broken bones. So remember the rule that those who don't cruise rarely bruise. And then entering the faces P portion of the rule, you can see multiple examples of torn frenula here in these photographs. Here's a torn maxillary frenulum. Here's a torn sublingual frenulum here and here, and then another maxillary frenulum that's torn is there as well. So we have to make sure, especially in our infants who are not yet mobile, to include examination of the frenula as part of our physical examination so that we can detect these injuries if they exist. Now, One point of caution about the frenulum tear: once children are old enough to become independently mobile, they can fall and hit their mouths on hard surfaces like the side of a coffee table, for example, or the bar in the crib railing in their crib if they're jumping up and down in the morning and hit their mouths. So that can occur. The maxillary frenulum tear can occur accidentally once children are mobile and active. Here's another example of a completely avulsed frenulum. And that incidentally is, those are the thumbs of mom. That is why they are not gloved. I just wanted to point that out. And then again, we have angle of the jaw bruising. So again, this tends to overlap a bit with the neck bruising, but all three of these children, the two on the bottom are the same child, are victims of abusive head trauma. And then we have the fleshy part of the cheek for the faces P. Anytime we see the soft portion of the cheek with bruising, like right here, that is concerning because there's no bony prominence underneath there. And accidental bruises tend to occur over bony prominences. I'll tell you more about that here in just a moment. And then here are a couple of examples of eyelid bruising. and then subconjunctival hemorrhage. So these are the hemorrhages that we see over the whites of the eye. These can be common in the neonatal period as a result of the birth process, but after that, they become significantly less common and are associated with inflicted injury. You can see in this child on the right that there also is eyelid bruising as well. And then finally, the P stands for patterned, and we will talk more about patterned injuries here in just a moment. This picture here is a cluster of four bruises kind of arranged in a semicircle. This is an example of a fist or a punch mark. So those bruises are from the knuckles of the fist that, that punched this child in the chest. So remember the 10-4 faces P rule. I won't read those to you again, but I think it's helpful to have one last slide to review those. And then we'll talk about patterned injuries here. And I'll go through these relatively quickly. Slap marks, loop marks, other patterned injuries that can involve other household objects, bite marks from adults and other children. So inflicted slap marks commonly are on the left side of the cheek. They tend to slope somewhat downward, or they can be perfectly horizontal, but they tend to slope from the temple sort of toward the tip of the chin. They can involve the ear and they can extend back into the hairline as well. And the bruises are actually a negative impression of the open hand that has struck the face. And then this is a non-cartoon example of slap mark. This is the same child, same injury, just I think about a day apart that these pictures were taken. And the history was that he ran into this beadboard wall here. And thankfully, one of the nurses who saw him in the doctor's office did not believe that history and made a report to CPS, which then involved our team, and we were able to make the diagnosis of inflicted injury. You can't run into or be hit with something rigid and end up with bruising that conforms to the contours of the body. So that wall would not have wrapped around this child's face in that manner, nor would the child have been able to run into the wall with significant force to cause a negative impression from the wall. We tend to see these negative impressions from inflicted injuries, and we also can see them from other high energy mechanisms like children who are ejected from cars and who hit chain link fences, for example, and we can see a negative impression of the fence. Or sometimes the seatbelt is another example of how we can see negative impressions of objects accidentally. Here are more examples of inflicted slap marks. This is an example of one that's a little more horizontal. This little girl here, I include her because she has darker skin pigmentation, and you can see that these bruises are much more subtle. She has bruising under her eye as well. They can be harder to see on children with darker skin, so we have to be particularly prudent and careful to turn on all of the ambient lighting in the room. And as you can see from this photograph, the bruises can be a little more tricky to photograph in kids with darker skin as well, because you get that flashback from the flash of the camera. So it's best to use bright ambient light and no flash when photographing children with darker skin. And this is the same picture you saw earlier, which shows multiple blows with an open hand. And this just describes everything that I've already said about slap marks. And we're moving on to loop marks. So loop marks are anytime something thin and flexible is bent over on itself and used to more or less whip a child. And so you will see the negative impression. Again, you can see this when they're new, at least, you can see this double train track kind of appearance with loop marks that are either the edge of the belt or the cord or the charging cord, whatever the object was that was used to strike the child. These are more examples of loop marks. This is actually from a wire coat hanger here on the top left. You can tell from that classic angle. Down here in the middle, you can see a belt mark, and then this top right loop mark is from a cord. So this summarizes everything that I've already said about loop marks, and we're moving on to adult bite marks. You can see here that they look like opposing curvilinear bruises, or sometimes people will describe these as looking like parentheses. Sometimes they're in a perfect circle where they actually meet and aren't two separate bruises. It just depends on how the adult bit the child. You can see here that an ABFO, American Board of Forensic Odontology ruler, is being used to help photograph the injury. And you can see that the ruler is being held in the same plane with the bite mark. And that's really important when photographing injuries, is to make sure your size standard is not being held up away from the skin, because that distorts the size. Here's another example of a bite mark. This one has either this is suction injury in the middle of this, or it's crush injury to the soft tissue from the violence of the bite mark. And you can see that this bite mark has abrasions associated with it as well. And then all of these are additional examples of bite marks. And you might notice that all of these involve the face of the children. Here's an example of one that looks almost perfectly circular. All of these are inflicted adult bite marks where adults reported to us biting the children. So we know for sure that they aren't from other children. Yet you can see that this one is relatively small. A quarter is about 1 inch in diameter. And so you can see that this bite mark is just about the size of a quarter, which some might think would be too small for an adult, but indeed it was from an adult. So sometimes the adults just don't open their mouths very much, and they can make the bite marks look smaller. And then this is a summary of everything I've said so far about bite marks. One thing that I didn't mention is that if we think the bite mark appears to be relatively fresh, meaning it hasn't started to fade and turn yellow yet, then we can consider swabbing it with the swabs from an evidence collection kit, and this can help identify perpetrator DNA. So it depends on the different scenarios and the exact history for the mark. But when we see bite marks, we do take those very seriously, as they are indicative of more sadistic abusers. And then the last patterned injury that I'll show you here, sorry about that, is what is sometimes called the Feldman sign. So you can see bruising to both buttocks here on this young child, but you can see the linear component of the bruising here along the gluteal cleft. And that linear component is from a crush injury, from the child being struck with an open hand or some other object that crimps the edges of the gluteal cheeks together. So normal bruising on active mobile children tends to be on the front of the body over what we call bony prominences. So foreheads, elbows, knees, and shins get the brunt of typical accidental injury in mobile children. So bruising is extremely rare in preambulatory infants. It's a significant indicator of abuse if it fits into the 10-4 faces PED clinical decision rule and must be reported to CPS and usually police. More importantly, it needs to be medically evaluated. Bruising continues to be the single most overlooked sign of child physical abuse. And remember the 10-4 faces P bruising rule. I'm going to quickly talk about the medical evaluation for abusive head trauma, just so that everyone is familiar with the types of studies we tend to order. The head CT tends to be the frontline first test that is done when a child presents with symptoms of head injury, and we're looking for subdural bleeding or evidence of brain swelling. Any abnormal head CT gets an MRI of the brain and spinal cord. This can demonstrate more subtle brain injury that a CT can miss, as well as more subtle subdurals. We do a complete skeletal survey that is not the same thing as a babygram. It's a series of 21 different images. And then we have to make sure that we follow that up with another skeletal survey with some limited images in 10 to 14 days, because that can help highlight fractures that aren't yet visible because they're new. We do eye exams on children with abnormal head CTs to look for retinal hemorrhages. We do trauma and bleeding labs to screen for internal injury or evidence of bleeding disorder. And of course, we photograph all visible injuries and call DCBS and police immediately if abuse is suspected. From the outcome standpoint for abusive head trauma, we basically divide victims into thirds. About a third of the children will die as a result of their injuries. About a third of them will have moderate to severe permanent disability, and about a third of them will have subtle or no neurological deficits. When children do have disabilities, they can run the full spectrum of learning disabilities, emotional behavioral issues, speech language problems, vision, hearing problems, growth and hormone problems due to pituitary injury, and then gross and fine motor issues as well. The most common triggering situation for abusive head trauma is a crying baby. And as I mentioned earlier, the second most common is in the toddler age range with toilet training accidents. Feeding issues also are high on the list, along with child's perceived misbehavior or punishment that has gotten out of control. Anything that causes caregiver stressors from outside the home, like financial concerns or job loss, legal trouble, relationship problems, are going to increase the risk for abusive head trauma. Family factors can include domestic or family violence, military deployments and redeployments, as I mentioned, unemployment or financial stressors, anything that causes isolation. So pre-pandemic, I would talk about the isolation we sometimes see in rural Kentucky, where individuals live, sometimes miles from their closest neighbor. But certainly since the pandemic, the isolation that was associated with quarantine certainly did not do children any favors, as well as we did see have seen an increase in child maltreatment as a result of the pandemic. And then finally, animal abuse is often seen in conjunction with child abuse. Characteristics of the caregivers can include substance use disorders, undiagnosed, untreated, or unstable mental illness, low self-esteem, and poor impulse control. And probably one of the single most common caregiver characteristics that we see are unrealistic expectations for the child's developmental level. So anything we can do as providers to help caregivers have more realistic expectations for a child's given developmental abilities is an important prevention tool that we should take advantage of. Certainly immature parents with poor coping skills, criminal history, CPS history, especially if prior children were removed from the care of the caregivers, and then caregivers who were abused as children are at increased risk of becoming abusers themselves, although more likely than not, they will not become abusers. I think that's important to point out. So common examples of scenarios where we would see abusive head trauma is mom's boyfriend is newly unemployed and is now a full-time caregiver for her children. Baby's crying interrupts intimate time, video games, or televised sports. We have had a number of victims of abusive head trauma come in on Super Bowl Sunday and on Derby Day. And also another scenario is caregiver is irritable or impaired due to drug or alcohol use disorder. And it's important for us to understand that our own implicit biases can play a role in recognition and failure to recognize abusive head trauma. There's good research that shows us that we are most likely to overlook abusive head trauma in white families, two-parent families, middle-class, well-educated parents, basically families that the medical provider perceives to be similar to our own, very young infants who may have a normal neurological exam, and infants that have nonspecific symptoms only. Child characteristics can be any child under 3 years of age is at increased risk for abuse in general. Drug-affected infants, those with either neonatal abstinence syndrome or what we now call neonatal opiate withdrawal syndrome. Premature babies or those that had prolonged NICU stays. The idea there is that the hospitalization at times can interfere with the early stages of bonding between caregivers and a baby, multiples, so twins, triplets, et cetera, colicky babies, those with physical developmental disability, and those with chronic illness. And then I'll spend our last little bit of time here talking about prevention. First of all, education about infant crying and normal development. So realistic expectations is really important, and coping with crying and understanding that crying is not the baby's way of expressing that they don't like you, that it's usually the baby's way of communicating something important like hunger or discomfort or wet diaper or they're too cold or too hot, et cetera. Oftentimes we will hear from perpetrator confessions that they perceived the infant's crying to be disapproval or evidence of the baby not liking the caregiver. Early recognition of abusive injuries and protective interventions, also very important for prevention, secondary prevention. So contrary to popular belief, this form of abuse is rarely a one-time event. It's more often the culmination of an ongoing escalation of violence against the child. And non-offending caregivers are often unaware of the abuse. So this is really important when we are interacting with families. Oftentimes the caregiver that brings the child for care does not actually know what happened to the child. And they are oftentimes repeating a history that they were told by another caregiver who didn't come to the hospital. And remember, bruising in babies is not normal. And even if the history sounds plausible, we need to do the full evaluation for occult trauma anytime a non-mobile infant has bruising. And then promoting healthy relationships and caregivers. So educating parents about choosing appropriate caregivers for their babies, educating young people about safe and healthy intimate relationships, and frankly, non-intimate relationships as well, helping them recognize toxic relationships and possessiveness when they're younger so that they're less likely to get into those relationships as adults. Drug, alcohol, and mental health treatment for caregivers who need it. We have a mandatory reporting law here in Kentucky, just as we do in every state in the United States, and ours is very broad. It is any time a person has a reasonable suspicion that abuse, neglect, or dependency has occurred, we are required by law here in Kentucky to make the report. So here is the number for making the report, and there also is a website for professionals to make non-emergent reports, and that is actually the preferred method for a report if it's not an emergency. So don't be afraid to share what you've learned today with the other professionals at your workplace and in your social and family circles. You know, document signs and symptoms that you see, document things that caregivers say, take pictures of injuries or help establish a protocol in your organization for someone else to take pictures, and document any information you receive when you have suspicions. When you report to CPS, you are allowed to remain anonymous, but that really hinders CPS's ability to investigate. It also takes away the credibility that we have as medical providers or healthcare professionals making a report. So I strongly encourage anyone who is in healthcare, if you are making a report for a patient, identify yourself, explain that you're a healthcare professional that's taking care of the patient and what your concerns are. And that allows the CPS worker to follow up with you and ask additional questions. They will want to know the child's identity, the person believed responsible responsible for the maltreatment, if that's known. If it's not known, that's okay. The nature and extent of the maltreatment and where the child can be found now, again, if that is known. Be specific about your concerns and how certain you are that it's abuse. If you are sure that there are findings that are diagnostic of maltreatment, it's important to let the hotline know that right away. If you're worried for a child's life, say so. And if you know of any siblings, particularly younger siblings, make sure to mention they're in the home so that they can be checked on and brought in for evaluation if that's indicated. So take home messages. Abusive head trauma is the most dangerous and deadly form of child physical abuse. Experience tells us that we often fail to recognize early warning signs, and we therefore miss opportunities to intervene and prevent further harm to abused children. We all play a vital role in observation, documentation, and reporting, and the absence of risk factors is not the same as the absence of risk. Remember the 10-4 FACES P, bruising clinical decision rule. One thing I'm going to say about that I forgot to say earlier is this is a tool to help us decide whether or not to do additional evaluation. The 10-4 FACES P rule is not a diagnostic tool. So just because a child screens positive does not necessarily mean that they have been a victim of maltreatment. Long-term effects of abusive head trauma can vary from subtle learning and behavioral issues to complete dependence for all care and education of caregivers regarding techniques for soothing a crying infant and the dangers of shaking can be an effective prevention tool, as well as promoting healthy caregivers and relationships and early recognition and reporting. And with that, I will stop there and am available to take any questions you might have.
All right, thank you, Melissa. A couple of questions. So in the outpatient setting where concerning bruising is noted for non-accidental trauma, what advice can you give on how to inform a parent or caregiver of concerns and the next steps, which are often less than pleasant for all involved, especially going to the ED or notifying CPS?
So that is an excellent question and one that I get asked a lot. So the way that I approached this during the short time that I did general pediatrics, and I used this script multiple times, is something along the lines of, you know, mom and dad, using their name, of course, if you know it, Johnny looks really good on exam today, and everything seems to be in order except for one thing, and that's this bruising. This bruising is actually very concerning, and believe it or not, it can be a sign of something pretty serious. So because of that, I'm going to ask that you take him to the emergency department. I don't want you to panic. I don't want you to drive 100 miles an hour, but I'd prefer you not go home and pack a bag either. I'm going to call the emergency department, let them know that you're on the way, and they're going to do some additional testing, and then we'll be in touch from there. So if you notice from that little blurb, I never said child abuse. I never even said trauma. I just said that it was a sign of something serious, which is a truthful answer, because oftentimes that, maybe not often, but sometimes the bruising is a sign of ITP or some other bleeding disorder or some other serious illness like leukemia. So that child needs to be checked for all of those things.
Okay. And do you ever have trouble with insurance paying for kind of all these abusive workups?
Not that we hear much about. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen. So I want to make sure to put that qualifier on there. For the most part, insurance covers this workup the same way it covers the workup for cancer or anything else that's a serious illness. So that is not generally a barrier in situations that we've been told about.
Okay. Do police need to be contacted immediately if abusive head trauma is suspected, along with CPS, or only after further investigation by the medical team?
That's a great question as well. I think at whatever stage you feel confident that a crime has been committed, that is when police need to be notified. And historically, we have relied on CPS to notify police. That's probably not the safest approach anymore, as much stress as is on the CPS system right now. So we're trying to be better about concurrently notifying both police and CPS. Now, if we are not sure sure of the diagnosis or we think there's a very reasonable chance that there is an alternative explanation, then it is perfectly acceptable to hold off on notifying police until that's more clear. Our team can help make that decision as well.
Okay. And how do you know if a bite was done by a child? A parent told me the child did it, a bite on the arm. Do I send all these to the emergency room?
No, you don't have to send them all to the emergency room. And it can be very tricky and frankly impossible to know if a bite mark is from a child. I think that if that history is offered openly and readily, and it's not a bite mark on a young baby, then that can be accepted at face value. If there are other indicia of abuse, you know, a history of unusual bruising or broken bones, or you're aware of domestic violence in the family, those are the things that might tip you into sending that child to the emergency department. But no, in general, children with bite marks where the history is that it's from another young child do not need to be sent to the emergency department. If you have questions and you aren't sure, call our team, please. We're on call 24/7, 365, and we can help you make that decision.
Okay. And then can you give a recommendation when we as caregivers disagree with the CPS ruling?
Oh, that's a great question. So I think our team can help mediate that to some degree and help everyone involved have more realistic expectations of one another. We can also work our way up the chain. So oftentimes, if we don't agree with the CPS decision making, we will work our way, you know, to the supervisor, to the SRAA, that to, you know, basically all the way up to contacts in Frankfurt if we need to. And we have done that before successfully and have an established way to do that. So please allow us to help when that happens. And, you know, if it turns out that the CPS ruling is actually consistent with what our team would expect, we can help explain why so that you can feel better about, you know, the ultimate determination.
Okay. And then lastly, this is, here's another one. This more of a comment. Can you remind people that they are supposed to report if there are any concerns to CPS? Many times they say they sent to the ED, but there's not a report done. And that might be just, you know, the ED might have a different view of the entire issue, but
just
one caregiver.
Yeah, I think that that's really important. And, you know, one thing that I'll point out about that is it's really important that if you have firsthand information, you should report yourself. For example, if you're a nurse, it's best for you to make the call to CPS rather than have the doctor make the call if you have firsthand information that you need to share with CPS. So we aren't actually fulfilling our mandatory reporting requirement by telling someone else in our workplace.
Okay, that's good advice. So I often find CPS doesn't provide any follow-up on reports. Should they or do they?
Do they? Often not. And it's a direct result of how understaffed CPS is right now. If you aren't aware through the news coverage, CPS is at an all-time staffing low. And it is beyond a critical situation. We have teams in Louisville, for example, that generally have between 17 and 25 investigators who have 3 and 4 investigators right now. So that just sort of gives you a sense. So consequently, a lot of that follow-up work is not happening because they're needing to prioritize the most important activities for their workers to do. That doesn't mean you can't call for follow-up, and you can also call our team. Often we are aware of the status of a case and can fill you in if we've been involved in the case.
Okay, and is there any role of head ultrasound in abusive head trauma?
That's a great question. So yes and no. Certainly if you have an infant coming into the emergency department and you have point of care ultrasound and you want to use that as a screen before the child gets a head CT, that's acceptable. But it's important to understand that head ultrasound is nowhere near sensitive enough to be a independent, reliable test for screening for subdural hemorrhage. So consequently, a CT scan or ultimately an MRI are indicated. Head ultrasound does not have a role as an independent screening modality for abusive head trauma.
Okay, and lastly, there's a request that you share your phone number.
Sure. Our office number is area code 502-629-3099. Again, that's 502-629-3099. You can also reach us by calling the Norton Children's Hospital operator and ask for the child abuse person on call, and we can be reached 24/7, 365. So if you need us immediately and you happen to get a voicemail at the office, which sometimes happens, call the operator and you can reach one of us that way. So we are back with abusive head trauma, and we are going to do some clinical case reviews. Case one, we have a four-month-old infant who's brought to urgent care with swelling noticed on her head this morning when she woke up. There's no history of trauma reported. Mother and father report they are the only caregivers. There's no bruising on exam, but on review of systems, the parents mention that there has been bruising in the past and that they feel she bruises easily. So the first question we need to answer is, can this be fully evaluated at an urgent care? And the answer is no. This child needs to be transferred to a children's emergency department or a local emergency department for a full occult trauma workup. Occult trauma just means evidence of injury that would not have necessarily been suspected based on the history and physical alone. So in this child, she is sent to the emergency department and she has a head CT that shows a simple linear parietal skull fracture. Her skeletal survey and trauma labs are ordered but pending, and we also ordered second tier bleeding labs due to the history of quote unquote easy bruising. And I put that in quotes because that is the language that the parents used, but also because we know that it may not be that she bruises easily, but rather that she has been abused depending on the outcome of the workup. So additional history is obtained to screen for trauma in the week prior to the swelling being noted. This is important because simple linear parietal skull fractures or skull fractures in general often will have a delay in the appearance of the overlying soft tissue swelling. So just because the swelling is seen on Monday doesn't mean that the injury happened on Monday. It could be up to a week old. So we want to make sure that we're clear about that when we're asking the caregivers for history of trauma. And indeed, in this case, there was still no history of trauma of any kind. So this is very concerning because this is a four-month-old who can't cause injury to herself. So police and CPS are called along with the pediatric forensic medicine team. So as I mentioned, we are very concerned that not having a history for a serious injury definitely gets our attention when it comes to child maltreatment. And of course, babies shouldn't have bruises, if you remember the 10-4 faces P rule. The initial bleeding labs have come back as normal at this point, as well as the skeletal survey has come back completed. And there are multiple healing rib fractures, both posterior laterally. Here you can see the lumps of callus that have formed along the ribs. You can see posterior medial rib fractures here, and then there are some over on the right as well. So this is evidence that injury occurred at least 2 weeks ago. So it takes about 2 weeks for callus to show up in an infant on for rib fractures and for most long bones as well. So that is evidence of previous injury in addition to the current acute skull fracture. Ultimately, all of the bleeding labs returned as normal, and the follow-up skeletal survey revealed additional healing posterior rib fractures that were not present on the initial skeletal survey. So it's important to recognize that the follow-up skeletal survey done in 2 weeks will usually uncover on, you know, as a group, they will uncover about 30% more fractures than what we see on the initial skeletal survey. So that is a really important part of the workup. So what are the lessons we've learned from this case? Well, when we have no history of trauma to explain an obvious traumatic injury, that's concerning for abuse. There were no other caregivers in this case, so we know that the injury was caused by either mother or father, or there have been other caregivers that mother and father aren't disclosing, and that would be for investigators to explore. We have a history of bruising in a non-mobile infant. Remember that those who don't cruise rarely bruise, and remember the 10-4 faces P rule. The full workup revealed additional occult injury, so it's important to do the full workup on every child in which it's indicated. There was no evidence of an alternative medical explanation. It's important to remember to get the follow-up skeletal survey, and it's also important to notify police and CPS in addition to the pediatric forensic medicine team. So moving on to case number two, this is also a four-month-old infant. This baby was dropped onto hardwood floor by mom about 20 minutes ago, and they present to the emergency department. The skin exam is normal except for slight swelling of the scalp. And on head CT, there is a simple linear parietal skull fracture. And the CT is otherwise normal. So we have the exact same injury that the last child had, except in this case, we have a history of trauma and we have timely seeking of medical care. The skeletal survey still needs to be done because we have a broken bone in a child under 1 year of age. So the skeletal survey appropriately was done and was normal, except for the known skull fracture, and all of the trauma labs were normal. So just a few words about linear parietal skull fractures. You can see it here on the x-ray, how it's just a little bit thicker here on the left. And as it comes forward, it tapers off into a point. And that is a simple skull fracture. It doesn't have any branches. Now in this drawing here, this is not actually a simple linear parietal skull fracture. This is actually a complex fracture because it has branches. But when we have simple linear parietal skull fractures, if they are from accidents, the most common histories that we get are a fall from bed or a roll off the bed or changing table or a fall from a caregiver's arms. When they are abusive, it is because of either impact to the head or the head is impacting something hard and solid. And so we will see skull fractures very commonly in young children from accidents, and we see skull fractures very commonly in young children from abuse. So the fracture itself is not what helps us determine whether the child was a victim of maltreatment. It is the history and the full workup and whether other injuries are uncovered that really help us understand how worried to be. And then it's of course worth mentioning that some linear parietal skull fractures are due to the birth process itself. So it's important to have a good birth history documented to know if forceps were used, for example, versus C-section, which would be a much less likely cause of a birth-related skull fracture. So in case two, these facts are all great. It was probably just an accident. In most cases like this, we would not call CPS because we have a plausible history to explain the injury, and we usually would not follow up or order a follow-up skeletal survey since no other injuries were found. So this was a reassuring case because it was an isolated injury. There was no delay in seeking care. There was a plausible mechanism. There is no history of previous injury, so no history of bruising or any other kind of injury in this baby. And the workup was done and was negative for occult injury. So this is an example of an accidental head injury that would not be considered abusive head trauma. Case three, an 11-month-old baby girl is brought by EMS to the emergency department because she became limp and unresponsive at home. She is now awake, alert, and in no apparent distress. So where do we start with this? Well, we start where we always do, which is obtaining a history. And when we have a case where maltreatment is on the differential diagnosis, taking a really careful, detailed history is important and establishing a timeline. So we want to obtain a medical history from caretakers for a minimum of 48 to 72 hours prior to the incident. So in this case, the incident was becoming limp and unresponsive at home. And one of the single most important questions for us to ask is, when was the child last seen in a normal or healthy condition? Meaning she was alert, oriented, she was taking bottles normally without vomiting, she was looking around, tracking, et cetera. Develop a timeline for who took care of the child after that point and the child's condition at each given exchange or change in caregiver. So in this case, father reports that he and mother were sleeping this morning when the baby awakened around 7 a.m. He got up and made her a bottle, but she was fussy and she wouldn't take it. And he says that she suddenly became limp and lifeless. She was normal before she was placed to sleep the evening before at 10 p.m. She was looking around. She was making eye contact. She took a bottle normally with no vomiting. And she routinely slept through the night as she did the night before. Baby remained limp and unresponsive for at least 10 minutes, according to dad's estimate, and didn't start to wake up until EMS arrived. Baby has not yet started pulling up or taking steps. So there was bruising on the baby's face and chest on exam when she arrived, and her right leg was in a cast. She had a head CT to evaluate for abusive head trauma, since she had a brief resolved unexplained event that could have been a concussion. And indeed, the head CT showed these acute subdural hemorrhages. That's the hyperdensities that you're seeing around the edge here that I'm pointing to here on the right, and there's some in the back here on the left as well. And those are acute subdural hematomas. The baby also had healing and acute posterior rib fractures on the skeletal survey. Her trauma labs revealed elevated liver enzymes, so she likely had abdominal trauma as well, and a low hemoglobin. And that low hemoglobin is not unusual when babies have lost blood into their heads. The cast was due to a broken tibia from 1 week before. It was casted, but no skeletal survey was performed. That was likely a missed opportunity, given that we recommend a skeletal survey for any fracture in a child under 1 year of age or in a child who's not yet taking steps and pulling up. And since there was bleeding on the CT scan, this child required an ophthalmology exam, and there were no retinal hemorrhages. Police, CPS, and pediatric forensic medicine were contacted. The investigators interviewed father in the emergency department, where he ultimately admitted to shaking the patient in frustration that morning when she wouldn't take her bottle. He also admitted to biting her on the face. And you can see here the picture on the left, you can see this jawline bruising, which would be angle of the jaw for the 10-4 faces P bruising rule. And you can also see torso bruising here. Again, there's angle of the jaw bruising on the left side of her face, two of them. And then there's this patterned injury here that the big blue arrow is pointing to. And that is an inflicted adult bite mark. And we know that because dad told us that he bit her. Also of note, she is not around other young children. And so consequently, there's no consideration that needs to be given to the possibility that this is from another child. Father also ultimately admitted to causing the leg fracture that the infant had as well. From a clinical perspective, this child did well overall. She continued to be awake and alert. She never had seizures as a result of her head injury. So thankfully, she fell into that third of patients that did well overall. Father, probably in large part because the child clinically did so well. Father was only given a year of probation by the criminal courts. And he went on later to murder an adult and went to prison for that. So what are the lessons that we've learned from case three? Well, concussion symptoms can be transient and they still warrant an emergent evaluation. So it was very important that EMS continue to bring that child to the hospital rather than telling her to follow up with a pediatrician, since she was starting to look more normal by the time that they arrived. A complete evaluation for occult injury and alternative medical diagnoses is important. Remember the 10-4 faces P bruising clinical decision rule. Remember that not all victims of abusive head trauma are neurologically devastated. This child fell into the first rule of thirds. And it's important to recognize that individuals who are a danger to children are a danger to society at large. And this case is a good illustration of that. Crimes against children should not be considered lesser crimes. And that happens quite a bit in the court system for reasons that we don't fully understand. Case four, we have a two-month-old that is dropped off at a sitter at 8 a.m., reportedly acting normally at that time. He was asleep in his car seat at the time he was dropped off. The babysitter called 911 2 hours later at 10 a.m. because the baby was found blue and unresponsive. The emergency department, when the baby is transported by EMS, discovers bilateral subdural hematomas on head CT, and police, CPS, and pediatric forensic medicine are called. So the importance of a detailed history when a child presents with altered mental status, as this baby did. We need to ask how the baby was acting that morning prior to daycare. So that would be a question for the parents. We also want to know how the baby was acting that morning after arrival at daycare. So that would be a question for the sitter. We want to know, when was the baby last alert, smiling, taking a bottle, focusing, interacting, cooing, and was the baby unusually sleepy at any point, fussy, irritable, vomiting, or having poor feeding or an unusual nature of the cry? So that middle bullet point of when the baby was last alert and smiling, that is establishing when the baby was last normal. And then the last bullet point is establishing when the symptoms started of head injury. So other things we want to know from the history is who's been around the baby, who else is at sitter's home, who else is at the baby's home, and has anyone else been around the baby? Don't forget to ask about pets and children, not because they really would provide a plausible explanation for the injury, but because sometimes they are invoked by perpetrators as the cause of the injuries when they actually aren't. So has the baby ever had symptoms like this before? And if so, who was caring for the baby when that happened? And has the baby ever had bruising before? Does the family feel that the baby bruises easily? And if so, who was taking care of the baby immediately before the bruising was noted? So all of this is important information to gather by the medical providers, and it's important to gather and document these details. But it's critical to defer the timing of injury to pediatric forensic medicine, because timing of head injury can be quite tricky, and doing it incorrectly can adversely affect the criminal case if there is one. It's important to document statements from caregivers, and if there are verbal children, from them as well, as close to word for word as possible, and you can use quotes when appropriate. So case four continued. The history for this child was that he slept consistently after arriving at the sitter's house. He never woke up after arriving, and sitter never tried to wake him until 10 a.m. When she found the child blue and unresponsive, still in the car seat. Parents report that the baby awakened normally this morning before being taken to the sitter, that he took a bottle and then he became fussy. Mother took the baby in the bedroom and, quote, put him to sleep. She denies doing anything other than rocking the baby to put him to sleep. The baby vomited as they were placing him in the car seat that morning to take him to the sitters. They changed his clothes and took him to the sitter without incident, but he slept the whole time. So after mom, quote unquote, put him to sleep, he never woke up again after that. And in the social history, three children that belong to mother do not live with her. And that's actually all we know at this point. We don't have any additional information, but that certainly can be a red flag. So what are the lessons that we learn from this case? Well, it's important to involve our team in abusive head trauma cases, and we can help with timing of injury for investigators. And the great thing is that that can help keep you out of court. It's important to obtain a detailed history and not make assumptions about where or with whom the injury occurred. Social history is important. Remember to screen for housing and food insecurity, history of untreated or undiagnosed mental illness, screen for domestic violence, but never in front of a partner, screen for substance use disorders, prior CPS, and criminal history. And these parents in this particular case presented well. We really can't tell who hurt a child just by looking at them or talking to them. So we need to be aware of implicit bias, which causes us to give the benefit of the doubt to people we perceive to be like us and to be more suspicious of people we perceive to be not like us. So case five, a 4-month-old boy presents for a well child exam and is noted to have 2 fingertip size bruises on each thigh. Parents explain that they came from a diaper change when the child was squirming. The social history really offers no red flags. The doctor has seen this family because of the older sibling for the past 2 years. So what should this doctor do? Well, unfortunately, this pediatrician in this case didn't have the information about the significance of bruising in an infant. This was about 20 years ago, and it was before we learned all that we know now about the significance of bruising in a baby. And so she documented the bruising at this well child visit and allowed the baby to go home. And 1 week later was when I met him. He was brought to the emergency department of Children's Hospital, unresponsive and having seizures. And he was ultimately found to have bilateral subdural hemorrhage, indicative of abusive head trauma. And he had 13 broken bones. And when I informed Dad about all of his injuries, Dad became tearful and outraged when I told him that someone had harmed his son. Interestingly, the pediatrician had described the family as, quote, very nice, no concerns, and under social history had documented family appropriate. If she had had the information that we now know about bruising in an infant, she hopefully would have sent him directly to the emergency department, which is what we should do when we see bruising in babies. So bruising in babies is not normal. Maltreatment can and does occur in quote unquote nice families. So we have to be aware of implicit bias when we're evaluating families. The absence of risk factors is not the same as the absence of risk. Just because there are no red flags with the family or on the social history doesn't mean that a child couldn't have been abused in that environment. And then our last case, this is a 4-month-old whose twin was admitted to the pediatric intensive care unit after a full cardiopulmonary arrest at home. The twin had multiple rib fractures, a liver laceration, and abusive head trauma, which ultimately proved fatal. This child, the twin, had no skin findings, and this is his picture here on the left. You can see that he looks calm and alert and interactive. He was active and even smiling in the emergency department. On his screening abdominal trauma labs, his AST and ALT were quite high, and his alkaline phosphatase was elevated as well. And his hemoglobin was on the low end of normal. So that's only part of his workup, but we're going to talk a little bit about forensic versus clinical significance, because that's really what this case illustrates for us. Most of us have been taught to identify clinically significant injuries. Those are injuries that we can affect their outcome by providing some sort of treatment or monitoring. In child maltreatment, though, it's equally as important to identify injuries with forensic significance. So that means injuries that are there but may not require intervention in order to get better. So even if they're not clinically significant, we want to identify all of the injuries a child can have because that can make a difference in making sure the child is moved to a safe environment. So in this case, because of those elevated liver enzymes, this baby needed an abdominal CT. So abdominal CTs are recommended for the evaluation of abdominal trauma in suspected physical abuse. And they're indicated for abdominal tenderness, distension, or bruising, or when the AST or ALT is above 80. Ultrasound, while useful at point of care for decision making in the first minutes of a child's presentation to the hospital, ultrasound is not adequately sensitive for forensically significant injuries. So ultrasound can miss injuries that can be identified on abdominal CT. And so consequently, if there is tenderness, distension, bruising, or elevation in the liver enzymes, an abdominal CT is the study that is indicated. And indeed, this little guy had a large right lobe hepatic laceration with an intraparenchymal hematoma. So he had a tear in his liver as well as a large area of bruising that was completely undetectable on physical exam. Multiple individuals had examined this child. He did not cry with his belly exam. His belly was nice and soft. And there were no masses or lowered liver edge. On his skeletal survey, he had multiple fractures that are highly specific for abusive injury. So he had three classic metaphyseal fractures. He also had anterior rib fractures noted on his abdominal CT. So you can see the little corner looking chip here on the right distal femur. And you can see sort of the smudged appearance and a lucency at the corner of the proximal right tibia, and then the distal right tibia has a corner fracture as well. So classic metaphyseal fractures are the same thing as corner fractures or bucket handle fractures. They're just multiple names for the exact same kind of injury. And these injuries are highly specific for inflicted injury, meaning we very, very rarely will see them from accidental causes. So unfortunately, 1 month earlier, before all of this happened, the index twin, the one who died, was seen by a specialist. And at that visit, minor, that's how it was documented, bruising was noted to the baby's face, and it was blamed on the family dog. The plan by that specialist was to inform the PMD, the primary care provider, of bruising so they can address any social issues. This is not the way we handle bruising in babies. Bruising in babies is a medical emergency and requires that the baby be sent directly to the hospital for a full evaluation. The note from this visit was faxed to the primary care provider the same week that the child ultimately died. So if there had been timely notification of CPS and the child had gotten a complete workup, most likely his rib fractures would have been discovered on skeletal survey and he would have been protected. So this was unfortunately a medical missed opportunity to save this child. So what are the lessons that we have to learn from this case? Well, bruising in babies isn't just abnormal, it's an emergency. And a seemingly plausible history is irrelevant to the need for a workup. In other words, it doesn't matter how feasible the history sounds to explain the bruising, we need to do the full workup regardless if it is bruising in a non-mobile infant. We need to remember that we are all mandatory reporters here in Kentucky. We need to remember that siblings of abused children are also at risk and need immediate evaluation. And we always need to remember, therefore, to ask about other children in the home. Babies can look really normal on the outside, and they can be very broken on the inside. So we can't trust our physical exam alone in evaluating these children. That is why we have to do the extensive occult trauma workup that is required in these infants. So just a couple of words about reporting. According to our law, any person in Kentucky who has reasonable cause to believe a child is abused, neglected, or dependent shall immediately report. And this is the number for the Kentucky hotline. You can, when you report to CPS, remain anonymous, but that really hinders CPS's ability to investigate. And as I mentioned earlier, they will want to know the child's identity. If the person, if we know who the person is that is believed to be responsible for the maltreatment, the nature and extent of the maltreatment, and where the child can be found now. We should be specific about our concerns and how certain we are that it's abuse. And if we're worried for the child's life, we should say so. And finally, mention younger siblings if applicable. And that is the end of our case review. Thank you very much for your attention.